I hope you have covered the anatomy part, so I will be only dealing with the disorder part. So first coming to hair disorders. Before that, I would like to clarify certain terms like alopecia, hirsutism and hypertrichosis. These three terms are commonly used in hair disorders and you should be clear about this. So what is alopecia? Alopecia just means loss of hair. So it can be further classified into non-cicatricial and cicatricial alopecia. Non-cicatricial is also known as non-scarring alopecia, and cicatricial is the scarring alopecia. Means the difference I will be dealing later. Hirsutism, it is the presence of excess terminal hair on the body of female in a male distribution. So first thing, there are two types of hairs in a human body. One is terminal hair, another is villous hair. Terminal hair are those which are found on your scalp. They are more thicker and darker in color. As compared to villous hair, they are small and fine, which are present over our other body parts. Okay, so in hirsutism, the excess in number will be only of the terminal hairs, and that will be present only in female. So hirsutism cannot be found on a male patient. And that too in a male distribution. What male distribution means here? That the pattern of terminal hair distribution is that is androgen dependent area. Means those part of our body which are sensitive to testosterone, like beard, moustache, chest, inframbrachial area, and tips of the shoulder. So whenever you suspect hirsutism, you should examine these particular sites in a female. Okay. Now coming to hypertrichosis. Hypertrichosis is the presence of excess terminal hair in any part of the body. There is no special pattern followed here. So hypertrichosis can occur both in male and female. And here also terminal hair is only increased. So coming to alopecia classification, there are two types, non-cicatricial or non-scarring alopecia and the cicatricial or scarring alopecia. Non-cicatricial alopecia can be further classified into localized and generalized. In localized, we'll be dealing with alopecia areata, androgenetic alopecia, traction alopecia, and teenage hepatitis. In generalized, alopecia universalis, this is one of the variant of alopecia areata only. The second is ectodermal dysplasia, shaft abnormality. Ectodermal dysplasia I will not be covering because it is more of a part, it is a different group of disorder where we have a deficiency of, when a patient has a deficiency of two or more than two structures which are derived from ectoderm. So that constitutes the three skin structure which are derived from ectoderm, that constitutes our sweat glands, our hair and nail. So any deficiency in those constitute the ectodermal dysplasia. Third, coming to the shaft abnormality of the hair. That is also beyond the scope of UG people. That is not important for you. Coming to cicatricial or scarring alopecia, it can be further divided into congenital, like aplasia cutis. Here there is deficiency of skin. In inflammatory, you have lichen planopilaris. It is a variant of lichen planus. Discoid lupus erythematosus, it is a variant of LE, or in common language, you know, SLE. It is a chronic form of LE, fine. Infective, favus and chorion, this is a type of fungal infection of hair. Nevi, like nevus sebaceous, it is more during the infancy period. You'll find that in infancy period. Traumatic, like physical or chemical, any kind of burns or trauma. Neoplasm, like basal cell carcinoma, idiopathic, like pseudoblood. Pseudoblood we'll be covering later. So, what is the main difference between cicatricial and non-cicatricial alopecia? How you are going to differentiate clinically? So, whenever you will see a patch of hair loss on the scalp, you will see, we have to judge it, whether scarring is occurring or not. Now, how will you know whether there is scarring or not? In that case, you have to see the hair follicle opening. If hair follicle openings are not destroyed, so it comes into non-scarring alopecia. So since the hair follicles are preserved, so it is reversible, unlike cicatricial alopecia, which is irreversible, since the main germinative part of the hair follicles are destroyed permanently. So skin over there is shiny and the follicular openings are absent, as compared to non-cicatricial, where the follicular openings are present. Other signs of inflammations like papules, pustules, scaling and hyperpigmentation can be seen in cicatricial alopecia, which is generally absent in non-cicatricial alopecia. But it is not always, because in some types of teenage hepatitis, scaling and pustules can be seen. But scaling is more or less can be seen in non-secretory alopecia, because pustules and more of inflammation goes more in favor of secretory alopecia. And it also justifies the prognosis of that patient. Suppose a patient has a hair loss and he is developing more pustules and inflammation, the prognosis is bad here. Accordingly, you have to manage the patient as soon as possible. So we will be dealing with each one of them. First, coming to alopecia areata. It is one of the most common causes of non-scarring alopecia that you see nowadays. And what is the cause of alopecia areata? It is generally associated with some autoimmune diseases. So it is autoimmune in nature, so it responds to immunosuppressives. Okay. So what is the thing which is happening here? You know about dermal papillae, which is generally present in the dermal area. Dermal papillae is basically composed of blood vessels, which is providing nutrients to the hair bulge. Hair bulge is the area where stem cells are present, which is mainly responsible for the hair growth. So here what happens, the cytokines comes and they attack the dermal papilla by attracting few lymphocytes, due to which there is decrease in the germinative potential of this hair and leading to hair loss. Other than that, genetic factors are also implicated because they run in some families. However, it is not fully known. And very important is emotional factor. It is very commonly seen that during the exams, a child comes to you and say that he is developing this patch of alopecia. In that case, you need to counsel them, which is very important. So coming to epidemiology, as I already told, it is one of the most common type of alopecia and is both present in male and female and can be started at any age. But the age factor is here important because it helps in prognostication of the patient. An early onset of alopecia areata has a poor prognosis. So how does it look like? It typically presents at a discoid patch of alopecia, which shows no scaling, papules, inflammation, atrophy. As I already told, it is a non-scarring alopecia. So the surface changes are generally absent. It is very smooth patch of smooth oval patch of hair loss present with the scalp area. And very important sign here is exclamation mark here. What is that? It is a pathognomic of this condition. Exclamation mark here, you will see only at the periphery of the bald patch. And what is it? I will describe that later, but this one is very important. Coming to the sides, it can occur in any hair-containing side of your body. And there are a few variants, like ophiasis pattern. This is important, because here the patient start losing hair in a band-like pattern at the periphery of the scalp. So this is important because ophiasis has got a bad prognosis. So in that case, you need to do a more vigorous treatment, right? Second is alopecia totalis, when there is a complete loss from the scalp. And in universalis, the loss of hair is from the whole body. Generally, it is associated with nail pitting and thinning of the nail pit. Here also, nail pitting is important. Why? Because the patient who has nail abnormality also has a bad prognosis as compared to normal people. So here we can see this is a bald patch of hair loss. Fine. And these you are seeing the periphery where few hairs are coming out. If you see that on microscopically, you know, this is the skin. This is the dermal part of the hair. This is the outer shaft that you can see. Here you can see there is a constriction. This constriction that is developing in the hair proximal to the scalp, this should not happen ideally. Ideally, the bulge is like that. The hair is wider at the skin surface, and as it grows, it becomes narrower towards the distal part. But here it is happening the opposite. So it is developing an exclamation mark here. Fine, exclamation mark. So this is the thing which is pathognomic of alopecia areata. It mainly develops because of dystrophic anagen phase. There are three phases of hair: anagen, catagen, and telogen. And when there is abnormal anagen cycle, it leads to the formation of this kind of hair. Okay. Now these are the patients. This is the patient who is see here. The eyebrows are also lost, as well as the scalp hair. So this is a case most likely of alopecia universalis. And here this patient is developing hair loss at the periphery of the scalp. This is what? Ophiasis pattern, which has a poor prognosis. Now here is a nail abnormality that you can see. What is it? You can see these small pits over the nails. Okay. This is nail pitting. Nail pitting is one of the most common finding in alopecia areata, and this is very important for MCQ also, because how will you differentiate nail pitting in alopecia areata from psoriasis? In psoriasis, the pits are more coarser and they're irregularly arranged. As compared to alopecia areata, they're more fine and geometrically arranged. That is important. It's not that clear in this picture, but this you should know. Sorry for the picture, it is not that clear, but I just want to make you know that in alopecia areata generally spares gray hair. Gray hair. So you can see a patch where all the hairs are lost except some gray hairs. Okay, this is one of the important finding for alopecia areata. So what is the course of the disease? The course is generally not predictable. Single lesions usually recover within a few months. Okay, so generally that few months will be around 6 months. And regrowth generally begins in the center of the lesion initially. And how the new hair look like? Their thickness is less. They are more like a villous hair. Okay, the hairs are thin and the color is also less pigmented as compared to the normal color, normal hair color. Fine. So this you need to prognosticate in the patient also. Okay, this is fine. If you've developed a patch of alopecia areata, it is going to come back on its own within a period of 6 months. So don't worry. After that, you prognosticate the patient. If it is a childhood onset, it has a bad prognosis. If there is history of atopy or widespread alopecia or ophiasis pattern, it has all got a bad prognosis. This you need to know. So what are the investigations you need to know to confirm your diagnosis? No investigations are required to confirm your diagnosis. This is a clinical diagnosis. So if required, since I already told that it is an autoimmune disorder, so it can be associated with other autoimmune disease. In that case, you can do certain investigation to rule that out. So what are the treatments that you can do? So first you will see what are the number of lesions. If the number of lesions are not that much and the patient is also quite fine, you can first counsel the patient that it is going to go on its own within a period of 6 months. If the apart from that, if it is present for a quite a longer period of time and the patient is quite apprehensive, we can provide the patient for some topical therapy. We provide intralesional corticosteroids into the bald patch. Apart from that, minoxidil, puvasol are also tried. Puva is soralin plus UVA ka combination. Fine. If the patient has extensive lesions like in alopecia totalis or universalis, in that case you can give some systemic treatment like oral steroid, soralin and UVA. Soralin is nothing. It is a photosensitizer. You can give soralin both topically and systemically. And after that, you can irradiate that site with UVA. It helps in decreasing the inflammation wala part. So it is used in extensive lesions. Apart from that, which has a more efficacy here is the contact sensitizers. These are DPCP and Cyadbin. They have got a good efficacy. And this also act by decreasing the number of the lymphocytes, which was present around the hair bulge responsible for alopecia areata, which I told you earlier. And the patient has got alopecia totalis, in that case, the prognosis is very poor. And most of the time, this topical and systemic treatment don't work. So in that case, you can go with wigs. These are the temporary things that you can advise these patients. Now coming to the second entity of non-cicatricial alopecia, that is androgenetic alopecia. So what is androgenetic alopecia? This is alopecia you generally see in your families also. Here you have got a genetic predisposition and it is present in the androgen dependent area. In males, you see a typical pattern of hair loss. I will show that later. And in the females, there is diffuse hair loss. What is the basic pathology? Basic pathology is miniaturization of hair follicle. What is miniaturization? It is a process of conversion of terminal hair into villous hair. This is miniaturization. Okay. So it has been found ki genetically, the studies have shown that identifies certain association of AGA with polymorphism of androgen receptor gene on X chromosome. So it has got some genetic susceptibility also. As part as hormonal as well as in males, alopecia is distinctively androgen dependent. So does not develop in males castrated at puberty. And in females, though thought it is genetically strongly predisposed, but it is not clear because many of the females who are developing AGA don't have any hormonal abnormality. So it is not actually clear. Clinically, in males, terminal hair is replaced by fine villous hair. And in females, the same thing happened. As well as the female, in female, the hair loss is diffuse, which often manifests initially as widening of the central parting. So here you can see this picture. There is widening of the central parting in the female. First, there will be diffuse hair loss. After that, this widening can be seen. This is a normal clinical picture where there you can see the frontal area and the the partition part has become widened. It has got a classification also, that is a Ludwig classification. This is the male pattern hair loss. See what is happening here. First, there is temporal recession of the hair. So first, this temporal part of the scalp has got affected. In the vertex area, then they coalesce, and this is the final picture. Why is this happening only in this area? Because the hair follicles, which are present in this part over the temporoparietal area and the vertex area, are sensitive to androgen, while the occipital part, of the scalp, there the hair follicles which are present, they are not responsive to testosterone. That's why this is known as male pattern baldness. It is also present in androgen sensitive, androgen dependent areas. So what is the course of the disease? This type of hair loss is generally progressive and it tend to lower down in the family members also. In women, you need to find out any other features of hyperandrogenism. And what are those features? Hirsutism, I already told, acne, clitoromegaly, and PCOD. All these history you need to take from the female patient. If they are present, you need to investigate them separately. So in males, no investigation is required. Females also no investigation required until unless there is evidence of virilization. So you have to rule out any androgen secreting pathology. So what are the history that you will take? Is there any history of hair loss, sudden hair onset hair loss, any rapidly progressive and advanced disease, and any association with menstrual disturbance, hirsutism, or acne exacerbation? You all need to ask the female patient. So what is the treatment? FDA. Only approved treatment for androgenetic alopecia is minoxidil. Okay. So in female, we give 2% and in males, we give 5%. There is a spray or dropper present there from which you measure it as 1 ml and you ask the patient to apply locally twice daily. But in that case, you also need to counsel the patient very quite properly because the hair is not going to come back before 3 months. It will take at least 1 to 2 months for the effect to come and for a proper hair growth. In that too, that also vary from patient to patient. It will take around 6 months. So what are the other things that can happen or that can be given? Are anti-androgen 5-alpha reductase inhibitors like finasteride. Finasteride and minoxidil combination has got a very good result. And apart from, hair transplant. Hair transplant is mainly more beneficial for male patient when they have lost a major part of their hair, when the topical treatments and the medication are not working. In that case, you can advise the patient. So what are the etiology? So now, sorry, coming to the next part is the telogen effluvium. In telogen effluvium, hair follicles pass through. Before coming to that, I would first like to say a few words regarding the hair cycle. Hair cycle, we have three phases, that's anagen, catagen, and telogen. Anagen is the growing phase, catagen is the phase between anagen and catagen. Telogen, telogen is the basically resting phase or the phase where the hair goes out. So anagen is for years, catagen is for weeks, and telogen is for months. Okay. So in a scalp, in a normal healthy scalp, around 90% of our hair are in anagen phase, 1% are in catagen phase, and telogen, around 10% of the hairs are in telogen phase. So adjoining hair follicles are not synchronous in the cycle in telogen effluvium. But sometimes what happens, anagen phase of several adjoining hair follicles are aborted and they simultaneously enter into the telogen phase, which results that all the hairs are then shed simultaneously, and this is known as telogen effluvium. So the patient suddenly comes to you and tells, I'm suddenly having a lot of hair loss. What is happening to me? In that case, you need to ask, please, history. So was there any history of infection, childbirth, trauma, stress? Any such history in the past 3 months can be suspected for the cause of telogen effluvium. Sorry. Now, what are the clinical features? One second. Sorry for the interruption. So what are the clinical features of telogen effluvium? Here the patient can complain with varying degrees of diffuse hair loss, which occur 2 to 3 months after precipitating any stimulus. And it can be associated with anemia and Bue's line of the nails. What are Bue's line? I will be showing you later. And in those patients, you always should get a CBC done to rule out anemia. Now coming to chronic telogen effluvium, it is a part of telogen effluvium where the hair loss persists for more than 6 months. It can generally occurs in women of 40 middle-aged women, where the patient typically complains that she is losing more than 100 hairs per day. So this is the definition for telogen effluvium, chronic telogen effluvium, that you need to ask this patient, because a 40 to 50 hair loss is not significant. And as compared to androgenetic alopecia in females, there is no widening of the partition and no miniaturization of the hair follicles. Investigation, you can get a trichogram. What is trichogram? You just pull out the hair and see under the microscope. So you can see telogen hair of around 25%. Okay, if it is telogen hair, I already told that it generally constitutes around 9 to 10% of our scalp hair. So if it is coming around 25%, this is going in favor of telogen effluvium. So what is the treatment? First of all, counseling is very important. You have to counsel this patient that the hair fall is going to stop spontaneously within 2 to 3 months. Because this is a normal telogen. This is a normal duration of telogen. Okay. Though hair growth which follows may be incomplete, but therapeutically you can give minoxidil 2% as tried with the variable success rate. Coming to the fourth entity is the traction alopecia. Traction alopecia is because of constant or prolonged traction, which is mainly seen secondary to certain hairstyles, like tight hairstyle, which is seen in sick males or school-going girls. Or in Negroes and African people, they do hot combing to straighten their curly hair. In that cases also, there is so much of traction applied, which can lead to secondary hair loss. So initially, the area of alopecia shows short broken hair. And since there is so much of hot combing and all those things, there can be inflammation. And I had told you in the first, second slide that wherever you find inflammation, there is more chances of going into scarring alopecia. So in this patient, traction alopecia patient, though initially they may present with non-scarring pattern, they may turn into a scarring scarring pattern of hair loss. So the side generally depends on the hairstyle, usually in the frontal area or on the margin of the scalp where there is maximum traction. And since it is non-scarring, it is reversible in the early stages, but non-reversible in the later part. Treatment is that patient should change the hairstyle and so that they can start making loose hairstyles and all. So this is example of traction alopecia. You can see here there is hair loss over the temporal part. This is a patient, African patient, where you can see this vertex area has developed this alopecia pass secondary to hot combing. This is the next thing, is trichotillomania. This is a psychiatric disorder. It has recently been classified into obsessive compulsive disorder. Here the patient starts on pulling his hair. And clinically, there is a patch of alopecia with hairs of different length can be seen, going in different directions. In those patients, psychiatric evaluation is very important. Here you can see this. There is hair loss and broken hairs of every length. It is not symmetric. Now coming to the second part, it's a cicatricial alopecia or the scarring alopecia. What are the main causes? Lichen planopilaris, discoid lupus erythematosus, and pseudopilaric block. Pseudopilaric block is a type of scarring alopecia for which no cause is identified. It generally presents as a patch of cicatricial alopecia with footprints and snow. Since I already told, it is often diagnosed in females, and the terminal hairs are distributed in the male dependent part, testosterone sensitive areas like beard area, mustache, chest, shoulder tip, periareolar, and infrabrachial lesions. It generally begins at puberty and progresses with age. Androgenetic alopecia, acne, menstrual irregularities, infertility, weight gain, and virilization may be associated with these. So in investigation, you need to rule out any other hormonal problem, and you need to do full endocrinological evaluation. In treatment, you generally provide the patient a cosmetic treatment like bleaching, waxing, thermolysis to help improve their cosmetic appearance. And if there is a part of some endocrinological abnormality, you can give some systemic anti-androgen treatment also. So this is a female where she has developed this terminal hair over the chin area. So this is a testosterone dependent area. Others are as tested in the dots. Now coming to the other entity, which is hypertrichosis. In hypertrichosis, there is excessive growth of terminal hair, but these are not following an androgen induced pattern. So it can be localized or generalized. Hypertrichosis are not doing that much in detail because this is not very important for you guys. But you should know, in hypertrichosis, we should always take history of certain medication. It can be mainly drug abuse like steroids, cyclosporin, all those things. Now coming to disorders of nail. Diseases of nail predominantly cause cosmetic disfigurement, though some may be symptomatic. Sometimes changes in nails help to corroborate diagnosis of a skin disease or be a clue to systemic disease. So diseases of nails are classified as congenital, traumatic, infectious, neoplastic, and secondary to dermatological diseases. Congenital abnormality of nail can occur singly or can be part of a syndrome. One of the syndrome here is Parthenope congenita. It is an autosomal dominant disorder where nail is grossly thickened and is associated with thickening of skin on pressure points. Oral lesions can be seen in the form of leukoplakia, as you can see in this picture. The nail is grossly deformed and hyperkeratotic, and the leukoplakia, you can see, leukoplakia is nothing but white patch that will drop over the tongue. This can be premalignant as well. They run in family. Now, nail changes can also be secondary to trauma, like splinter hemorrhage, subungual hematoma, where in splinter hemorrhage, the nail blood vessels which are present in the nail bed can be ruptured. And since the nail vasculature is arranged longitudinally, the hemorrhage also, you see, appears linear. And they are seen under the nails of a manual worker, which can be secondary to certain trauma, or you can see that in subacute bacterial endocarditis also. Now, coming to subungual hematoma, they also occur secondary to trauma and they appear quite dark, which is some dark thing is present between your nail fold, between your nail plate and nail bed. In that case, you need to differentiate that from subungual melanoma because that also appears black. Chronic injury, pressure injury, and injury from ill fitting shoes can also lead to certain nail changes like onychogryphosis. Onychogryphosis is nothing but it is gross thickening and curving of the nail. Apart from that, ingrown toenail can also be seen, and onycholasis, which is separation of the nail plate from the nail bed. Nail biting is another thing which can be seen in children generally, where they generally bite their nails and they have frayed cuticle. Frayed cuticle is very important because it suggests some kind of psychiatric problem. Other is tick dystrophy, where there is habit of picking cuticle of nail or repeatedly rubbing it. This causes a groove in the center of the nail bed with transverse ridging, which is radiating from the groove and similar to a ladder. Chemical injury of the nails can also occur by certain chemicals, which can lead to lamellar splitting of the distal end of the nail plate, commonly seen in housewives and bakers. Apart from that, certain cosmetics which are used in artificial nails, like formaldehyde, can also lead to nail changes. This you can see here. This is a habit tick deformity. Here you can see this transverse groove is present from which further radiating grooves as can be seen. This is in the sentence of psychiatric patient. And this is lamellar splitting of the nail plate, which occurs secondary to certain chemicals. Coming to a very important entity here is onychomycosis. This is the fungal infection of the nail, also known as tinea ungua. Okay. Fungal infection of the nail can be because of various types of fungus. One of them is dermatophytes. And dermatophytic infection is only known as tinea ungua. Okay, so onychomycosis is a broader term, and tinea ungua is one of the parts. as you can see in this picture, there is thickening of the nail plate with tunneling, and here is the submungal debris. And then clinically, you can see this yellowish discoloration, which is developing in the middle of this nail with nail plate crumbling. So this is very important table where you need to differentiate the psoriatic nail from a nicomycotic nail. In psoriasis, the nail involvement is quite symmetrical as compared to fungal infection where it is asymmetrical. In psoriasis, it begins proximally because here the nail matrix are involved. While in nicomycosis, the fungus invade the nail from the distal part, so it starts from the distal area. Pitting is more frequent in psoriasis as compared to nicomycosis. Nail plate is thickened and discolored, while tunneling is not there in psoriasis as compared to nicomycosis. Submungal debris can be seen, which is quite firm as compared to friable debris seen in nicomycosis. In investigation, we will do a QH preparation of the nail plate, which you will see the fungal hyphae, and you can also send the same thing for the culture. In treatment, you will give systemic terbinafine. Treatment antifungal is very important because nowadays we are developing many cases of antifungal resistance among the tinea patients. So the two antifungal which are quite effective in this condition are terbinafine and itraconazole. And if disease is symptomatic or cosmetically disfiguring, they can also add on with some topical therapy like amdolphin and cyclopidox. Coming to the next indicator, that is paronychia. Paronychia is inflammation of the nail fold and could be acute or chronic. In acute, it is mainly because of bacterial, which involves like staphylococcus, which enters the nail fold. So to break in the skin of nail fold, and it is causing factors here are chronic paronychia, nail biting, and hand nails. Clinically, the nail fold is swollen, red, and tender, and pus may be visible under the nail fold or on the nail bed. It may be associated with lymphadenopathy and gastrointestinal symptoms. Some anti-staphylococcal antibiotic like erythromycin and doxycycline. And surgical drainage can be required if there is accumulation of abscess formation. In chronic paronychia, the inflammatory dermatosis of nail folds, it occurs secondarily to the nail matrix and nail growth, and it is because of some microbial colonization, which occurs secondary to which generally occurs due to candida, staph, and gram-negative bacteria. And wet work is one of the most important predisposing factor here. Clinically, the nail fold is swollen and rolled, and sometimes a bead of pus can be traced from under the nail fold. And over time, adjacent nail plate also become rigid and discolored. In investigation, you will do the investigation to rule out certain immunocompromised status, say diabetes, general candida infection, and secondary bacterial infection. It may respond to potent topical steroids, which if injected locally or systemic steroids. So nails and systemic diseases. Nails may provide certain clue for systemic diseases like clubbing, where there is bulbous enlargement of the terminal phalanx with an increase in the angle between the nail plate and nail fold. Deformities of nail plate like Wallonecki and Bue's line, where nail plate is thin, and severe cases they can be spooning can be seen. In Bue's line, transfer grooving can be seen, which appears simultaneously in all the nail plates. The groove moves distally as nail grows and disappears in 6 months. This is important because in Bue's line, you can predict actually ki, after how many months back there was some systemic illness and it, how many duration it persisted. So this is a picture showing clubbing. This is onychomycosis. Onychomycosis is separation of the nail plate from nail bed, which starts from the proximal nail fold and then moves distally. Now there are certain color changes in the nail, like leukonychia, where nails appear white. It occurs in hypoalbuminemia and cirrhosis of liver. Melanocytia, the nails are pigmented. Half and half nails, where the proximal half of the nail is white and the distal half is brown or red, seen in chronic cranial failure. In teres nail, proximal 4/5 of the nail is white and the distal tip is normal, seen in liver diseases. Certain changes can also be seen over the nail fold, like telangiectasias, erythema, and thrombocapillary, which are seen in connective tissue diseases like dermatomyositis and SLEs. Cuticles may be frayed in connective tissue diseases, and also nail biter and certain psychiatric disorders, as I already told before. So these are the summary of the hair and nail disorder that you commonly see. If any doubt, you can anytime contact me. Please let me know. You can put that in the chat box. Thank you.